In this video and subsequent few videos, I am going to discuss about protein sequencing. We know that proteins are unbranched chain of amino acid, right? So suppose this is unbranched chain of amino acid, that means it is a polypeptide or protein. So it has only two end. One is amino terminal, and other one is the carboxy terminal. Amino terminal is also called as N terminal, and carboxy terminal is also called as C terminal. And by convention, whenever amino acid sequence of any protein is mentioned, it is from the N terminal to the C terminal. Now, by being a protein sequencing, we mean to say that we want to decide what is the sequence of amino acid in this particular protein, right? In 1953, there was one scientist, his name was Frederick Sanger. That is Frederick Sanger. He first invented a method to determine amino acid sequence of protein. Okay, amino acid sequence of protein. The first time its method was invented by this Frederick Sanger, and for this amazing discovery, he got the Nobel Prize. And first he determined the sequence of insulin. Insulin is one hormone which is chemically a protein. Right. So, Frederick Sanger, in his lifetime, he received two Nobel Prize. One Nobel Prize for this amino acid sequence of protein, and second Nobel Prize for determining the method of nucleotide sequence. Right. So, it seems that Sanger was so much fascinated about the sequencing of monomeric unit. Right. And for that, he got two Nobel Prizes. So, in this video, we will talk about the amino acid sequence of protein, how to determine it. So, basically, protein sequencing is a multi-step process. It is not a single step process. We will understand all of the step of protein sequencing one by one. So, to understand step one of protein sequencing, let's take example of hemoglobin. Hemoglobin. In this hemoglobin, this globin is the protein part, right? And it has four chains. Two alpha chains and two beta chain. So suppose this one is alpha chain, this one is also alpha chain, and this one is beta chain, this one is also beta chain. Now all these in globin, these all four chains are interlinked by these non-covalent interactions, right? Such non-covalent interactions are there, and most of the time it is a hydrogen bond. So first we have to get rid of all these hydrogen bonds, then only we can separate these alpha chains and beta chains, and then only we can determine their amino acid sequence. So to remove these hydrogen bonds, we can use four different techniques, right? So the first technique is extreme of pH. Second is high salt concentration. Third is 8 molar urea solution. And fourth is 6 molar guanidinium hydrochloride. So 6 molar guanidinium hydrochloride. We don't need to use all these four techniques. We can use any one of technique and it will easily break down these hydrogen bonds. So once you take this step, then what will happen? All the alpha chains and beta chain will get rid of the hydrogen bonds, right? So we have this beta chain like this and alpha chains like this. So now the problem is that this alpha and beta, all hydrogen bonds are broken, right? But they are still in one single mixture. Now what we want to do, we want to separate alpha chain from the beta chain. So for that, we can use chromatography. So by the chromatography, we can separate all the polypeptide chains. Okay. So once we do chromatography, on one side, we have alpha chains and another side, we have beta chains in two different solution, right? So by the chromatography, what we had done, we had purified we had purified individual polypeptide chains. And once they are in separate solution, we can move on for its amino acid sequence determination. So, this step 1, it applies to which protein? It applies to heteromultimeric protein, which has more than one polypeptide chain, right? So, if we want to write step 1, we can write that if protein has more than one polypeptide chain, if protein has more than one polypeptide chain, then we have to separate all the chain and purify it. So, all the chains are separated and purified. This step 1 applies to only those protein which has more than one polypeptide chain. Okay. So, I hope step 1 is clear. Now, let us look at the step 2. Now, to understand this step 2, I will take example of insulin. And this insulin is the same protein which was first amino acid sequence was determined, right? So, this insulin, it has two chains. This is A chain which is shorter one, and this is B chain which is longer one. This is B chain. This is again N terminal and C terminal. This is also N terminal and C terminal. Now, in these A and B chain, on the A chain, on the 6th position and 7th position, there is a cysteine residue. This is 6th and this is 7th. Okay. And also on the 11th position also, there is a cysteine residue. And on the 20th position, again there is a cysteine residue. Here also in the B chain, on the 7th position, there is a cysteine residue. This is 7th position. And on the 19th position, again there is a cysteine residue. Now, what happens between the 7th cysteine of A chain and 7th cysteine of B chain, there is a disulfide bond. We know that cysteine is a sulfur containing amino acid. Here between 20th cysteine and 19th cysteine, there is a disulfide bond. And between the 6th cysteine and 11th cysteine, there is a disulfide bond. So, we can say that it is two interchain disulfide bond and one intrachain disulfide bond. Why we are discussing about disulfide bond? See, in case of hemoglobin, what was there? There were non-covalent interaction between two different chain. But in case of insulin, there is a covalent interaction between this A and B chain. Now, by using those method like pH extreme or high salt concentration or high concentration of urea or high concentration of guanidinium hydrochloride, we cannot break down this disulfide bond. We have to get rid of all this disulfide bond. Why? We want to get rid of this two interchain disulfide bond. Why? Because we want to separate A and B chain. Then only we can determine the amino acid sequence of A chain and amino acid sequence of B chain, right? Now, why we want to get rid of this disulfide bond? This is because when we want to determine the amino acid sequence of this A chain, at that time it will interfere, this disulfide bond will interfere. So, we want to get rid of all the disulfide bond, all interchain as well as intrachain disulfide bond. So, how to do that? So, let us consider any one of disulfide bond. Suppose this is A chain, it is cysteine residue. This is B chain, it is also cysteine residue. Suppose we are talking about this particular disulfide bond. And whatever we discuss, it will also apply to this one and this one disulfide bond. Okay. It is this disulfide linkage like this. Now, we want to break it. So, to break down this disulfide linkage, we have two different methods available. In the one method, what we can do? We can treat this insulin protein or any disulfide containing protein with reducing agent. So, we can use reducing agents. We want to reduce this disulfide bond. So, as a reducing agent, we can utilize 2-mercaptoethanol or dithiothreatol. So, we have two options over here, 2-mercaptoethanol or dithiothreatol. It is also called as DTT, right? If you treat this particular disulfide bond with this reducing agent, we can get reduced form. Okay. So, this is first chain, let us call it as A chain. So, now this disulfide bond is broken and so I had written SH. On the other chain, there is cysteine, and it will like this. So now disulfide bond is broken, but the problem is that in its reduced form there is a tendency to recombine this SH group, and again it can make disulfide bridge. So this become reversible. We want to permanently dissociate this disulfide bond, right? So we have to further process these both chains. So to process it, we have to modify this SH group, and to modify it, we can alkylate it. So we can use alkylating agent. So there will be alkylation of this SH group. So as an alkylating agent, we can utilize iodoacetate, or we can utilize 3-bromopropylamine. So when this SH group comes into the contact with this alkylating agent, this SH group becomes alkylated. So this is cysteine, and this SH will now be bound with the alkyl group. Here also this cysteine and its SH group will be bound with the alkyl. So now they cannot recombine. Okay. So by this we have separated A chain and B chain, and this is true for any disulfide bond containing protein. Okay. So if we treat this insulin molecule with the first reducing agent and then alkylating agent, then we can get rid of all these three disulfide bonds. So we can have a separate A chain and separate B chain. Okay. The other method, the second method to break down this disulfide bond, is to treat it with the performic acid. What this performic acid will do, it will break down this disulfide bond. So we will have like this. This sulfur, it will bind with 3 oxygen atoms. So it becomes SO3-. The same will happen with the second chain also. So SO3- over here. Now here also we have altered the chemistry of this sulfur group, right? Of this SH group. So here also there is no any chance of recombine to make a disulfide bond. And second thing is the negative charge. Because of the negative charge, this both will repulse each other. Okay. And that will be our added advantage. So in the step 2, we had broken down this disulfide bond, right? So what will be our second step? Second step is the cleavage of disulfide bridges or bonds. Cleavage of disulfide bond. Okay. It may be interchain or intrachain. So once step 1 and step 2 is over, step 1 and step 2 is over, we have our polypeptide chain in its purest form. We have a single polypeptide chain. Okay. We have only a single type of polypeptide chain. So I hope till now everything is clear. So in this video, I discuss about the step 1 and step 2 of the protein sequencing. The remaining steps I will cover into the next few videos. If you have any query or confusion, please write it down in the comment section below, and see you in next video. Thank you.